joy. I would just like to give a very big thank you to my Tier 5 channel members and patrons. Bob the Dragon, Data Magnet, Cat Crab Lobster, Duck Machine, Try Again 95, Estrella the Dreamer, Mezik, Feudic Joel, German Chemist, and Casper Amholtz. Thank you again very much. Gibbon and Tigers, written by Tal Mikal. Glock was actually vibrating with excitement, although he would never let his bridge crew know it. Outwardly, he has appeared as calm and dignified, like a commander he now was. Now that he was of age, his family had granted him command of a state-of-the-art warship, and he was free to hunt his way across the stars. Tradition dictated that he would tow his first captured ship back to his homeworld to prove himself. The more dangerous and mighty his first prey was, the more respect his rivals and elders would give him. Glock had an ambition, and he would prove his worth. He captured a human ship, maybe even one of their long-range transports. No one had the might to attack the human in generations, and peace had made his people complacent. Even his own proud family seemed more interested in trade or talk when it came to the humans. As a cub, Glock had even mocked several of his uncles for acting like merchants with the humans. The shame in their eyes, they simply told him that space is far more complex than seemed to a young cub, and that he would understand when he was older. Well, he was older, and he understood that they were weak, and they were cowards. None of them would call him a cub when he dragged his prey back to the docks and made them watch him tear it apart, making himself rich in exotic technology. Glock was interrupted from his present thoughts by his communications officer. She was as young as he was and had been personally picked for her family connections and pleasant appearance. "Commander, the message from your great-grandfather." She sounded impressed when she said it, shocked even. A rare treat. His great-grandfather was an important man with hundreds of distant cubs. No doubt, he was calling to wish him a successful hunt. He motioned with the awestruck girl to let the message be heard.
"Glock, what a proud day for an old man. It's good to see another of our pack seek his place in the stars. Would you take the time to speak to an old man in private?"
"Of course, Grandfather, but I must be quick. I'm already beginning my hunt, and communications may alert my prey." Laughter from the old man, in front of his bridge crew, no less, on this day of all days. Glock felt like a cub again. He maintained his calm in front of the crew and ordered the room to be cleared, so to speak with the patriarch with as much dignity as he could muster. Once he was sure that he was safely alone, no one could hear him. He answered, "Why do you laugh at me? I'm gonna make our pack proud, great-grandfather." Glock swore he may have mewed while he was talking. He was never more thankful he had cleared the bridge.
"Yes, I know, by preying on the humans, am I right?"
Again, with a laughter. How did he know? Glock hadn't told anyone of this ambition, and had even disabled his own transponder after leaving port. Come to think of it, how was he even being hailed right now? Thinking back, he realized his pretty young officer had been scared when she had informed him of the call. He already looked like a fool. "Yes, the humans. Why not the humans? My uncles are too afraid to do it. I will be the first." This time, roaring laughter, the old man actually started to cough.
"Such fire! My blood indeed. Glock, my dear cub, I want to tell you a story. A story I've told many of our family. Will you let an old man ramble?"
His patriarch didn't give him a chance to answer before he settled down his laughter and began.
"What do you know of the humans, boy? Did you know that they are not predators? Or that they are less than 300,000 years old? Their homeworld still has much of what we consider our ancient biological past intact. It's a fascinating place. I suggest you take some time to visit it, actually. I myself visited when I was about your age. That was a long time ago.
The old man was senile, thought Clark. Humans had only just been discovered around that time. There was no way a warlord like his great ancestor had been invited into their ancestral den. He would have heard about it growing up.
Sorry, I'll get to the point, young one. I know you're eager to begin your hunt. Well, the humans didn't actually have enough time to totally wipe out their nearest evolutionary rivals or even their ancient predators. Although they did come close, I want to tell you about gibbons and tigers. Here, I'll send you some pictures.
Clark's humiliation was now complete. He was getting a classroom lecture on the bridge of his own warship by a living fossil. Okay, I see them. I suppose the gibbon is related to the humans, and these tigers are their predators.
You would think so, but no. Tigers do not hunt gibbons. In fact, they are terrified of them. Ridiculous! Yeah, creature on my screen outweighs the prey by at least 8 times, scoffed Clark. Yes, closer to 12, actually, smiled his elder. Gibbons are territorial creatures. They have their own little slice of the jungle that they stay in for most of their lives. They share this jungle floor with the tigers. Tigers hunt meat, the gibbons eat fruit, and they mostly stay out of each other's way. Even better for the gibbons. The tigers are also territorial and keep out all other predators away. In exchange, the gibbons will alert the tigers when something unwanted trespasses in their shared jungle.
So, it's a symbiosis. Yeah, humans did something similar, and that's how they reached the stars so quickly.
Clark was confused, but relieved that he grasped the lesson. He had often wondered how the omnivore had risen to power so quickly. It was comforting to know a predator had assisted him.
Well, not exactly. Humans did domesticate another few predators, but that's not the lesson here, cub. Sorry, not a cub anymore, I know. Forgive an old one. Why does a tiger fear the gibbon?
The tone was kind, but Clark felt patronized. I have no idea, sir. Please tell me.
Clark let some of his contempt drip through against his better judgment. Careful, cub. You are a commander now, and you have a crew that trusts you to be smart. This'll be your last warning. I can't save you from what you've gotten yourself into if you don't take me seriously.
Clark suddenly felt a tingle in his nerves, and several realizations dawned on him. For starters, he was on a real-time channel and only in the borders of human empire. More alarmingly was that his bridge was empty, and while he had been talking, several terminals had started alerting their missing operators of various anomalies.
Why does a tiger fear the gibbon, honored elder?
There was a genuine urgency in the question this time.
Clever cub, listen very carefully and swallow that pride. When a new tiger is born and is finished weaning of its mother, it starts to explore. The gibbon watches this all happen from the trees of its jungle. Soon, the young tiger will stray too far from its mother, and the gibbon will come down to meet it. The tiger is too stupid to know the danger it is in. Its mother is the largest predator in the jungle, and it knows no fear. It will attack the gibbon. The gibbon will grab it by the tail and violently swing it around. Eventually, the cries of the cub will alert the mother, who will come running back. But now, the gibbon is back in the trees and dangling the cub in front of its mother. If the mother is smart and remembers the same lesson it learned during its old trial, it'll lay down and wait for the gibbon to return its offspring. If she does this, the gibbon will drop the cub and watch the mother discipline it for its foolishness. All will be well, and the cub will inherit its own slice of the jungle. If not, the gibbon will bash the cub on a tree, and a new line of tigers will eventually move in.
The cold implication washed over him with sudden clarity.
Elder, when will they come?
More laughter.
Only this time Clark had no pride left to answer the humiliation he felt.
Boy, who do you think called me? They've been watching you since you left port. Power down your ship and prepare to be towed back to our border. The humans will present you and your ship to your uncles and I. Don't feel bad. They do this to all of us.
The old man was cackling so hard, the camera was shaking when the call ended. Clark walked himself to his targeting system and saw that there was a warship, almost four times his own ship's mass, hovering only a few hundred meters from his bridge. They were so close that, with his optical cameras, he could see the bridge crew standing in front of the view screen. They even looked like the picture his great-grandfather had sent him. His own tail started to ache. End of story. And that, my friends, concludes this video. I hope that you enjoy.